Welcome to the Azure Cosmos DB Essential Series Season 2. My name is Mustafa, and I'm a product marketing manager for Azure Cosmos DB. In this season, we're going to dive right into some key concepts important for getting started with Cosmos. Last season, we kept it pretty high level. We talked about use cases, distributed databases, and consistency. In this season, we're going to dig one level deeper and discuss foundational concepts that you need to understand to get the most out of Cosmos DB. So in this episode, we'll cover how to choose a Cosmos DB API, as well as introduce the other concepts you need to know on day one, such as request units, schema design, and partition strategy. So let's get started. When we go into the portal and create a new account, the first thing we run into is the concept of a Cosmos DB API. Let's talk about how developers should be thinking about our APIs. The first question you want to think about when choosing an API is, am I building a new application or migrating an existing application? APIs are optimized around use cases, and effectively what Cosmos DB does is it has a core API which exposes the native engine and all Cosmos DB features, as well as offers service level agreements around performance. And then there's also a set of open source compatibility APIs, such as API for MongoDB, Gremlin API, Cassandra API, and Table API, created for people coming in from those different environments. If you're coming from Mongo, Cassandra, Gremlin, or Azure Table Storage, then the objective is pretty straightforward. In order to minimize the amount of effort needed to migrate into Cosmos DB, we recommend a Cassandra user onboard into the Cassandra API, and the same for Gremlin, Mongo, and Table. In contrast, if you're building a new application, we recommend you use the core API. It has all the financially backed SLAs, it's full of really useful features such as integrated cache that are not available in the compatibility APIs, and the primary advantage of using the open source compatibility APIs is that they allow you to leverage your existing skill set. If your team is already ramped up on Cassandra, Mongo, or Gremlin, it offers you the ability to onboard Azure Cosmos DB without really having to learn something new. Second, it also allows you to leverage the existing ecosystem. So if there's already tools or other frameworks that developers are used to, it allows them to stick to the same tooling. And third, it also allows you to take advantage of a diverse deployment strategy by using similar APIs for on-premise, hybrid, and multi-cloud deployments across different vendors. So the decision matrix comes down to optimizing around your existing configuration or choosing to use the core API and take full advantage of the native Cosmos DB engine's performance SLAs as well as additional features. Okay, so now that we understand the factors that influence whether to use a compatibility API or the core engine, let's talk about some of the foundational concepts we should know when getting started. Once you've thought through what you're optimizing for, there are a handful of things that every user should know about Cosmos DB prior to building an application. There are things you need to think about on day one. These have a huge impact on performance, scale, and cost of the solution, and they're difficult to change after the fact. And there are things that we can change later to further optimize our database. On day one, we need to understand schema design from the lens of normalization or denormalization. We need to understand partition strategy as well as the concept of a partition key. And we also need to understand request units, which are the way that Cosmos DB measures compute. So why is schema design so critical in a distributed database? Well, the moment I start changing what my data model is, the code is going to have dependencies on schema throughout. If you're a C# or Java developer, you're going to create a set of POCO or POJOs, and if you create these objects and then decide to transition your schema to a completely different layout, the business logic of your code will also have to shift. This leads to a pretty drastic amount of effort that we just want to avoid. A similar thing happens in terms of partition strategy. The partition strategy effectively is going to be how we lay out and give a placement hint to show that this piece of data can be found on node 1, node 2, or node 3. If we go and change what that placement hint is, you're basically taking data from node 1 and moving it to node 2, 3, or 4. Likewise, data from each of those other nodes will also need to reshuffle. Across these nodes, that's a heavyweight operation and not something you generally want to have on a live production runtime system. Now, Cosmos DB treats the partition key as immutable, and should you want to reshuffle or redistribute the data across a different partition strategy, that would require a data migration. So it's going to be really important to plan ahead. And we'll spend plenty of time diving into schema design and partition strategy in the next few episodes. Now, to share a bit about request units, or RUs, developers looking at Cosmos DB pricing, or who have already had a chance to jump right into the portal, probably first saw this concept of RUs and thought, what? In a nutshell, a request unit, or RU, is a form of compute. Basically, behind the scenes in Cosmos DB, What you're really getting is a fleet of nodes that have some database software and have some disks to go to and store that data. And request units are the way that we put a number on how much compute an operation costs. Think of them like CPU cores. Depending on whether you have one CPU core versus a million cores, you're going to get a variety of different performance and cost characteristics. The more compute available, the more throughput you can get out of your system. But at the same time, it's going to get more and more expensive the more compute is available. Request units are different from CPU cores because when provisioning hardware, you can't purchase a fraction of a core. However, RUs make it possible by focusing on the compute effort rather than the actual hardware. Azure Cosmos DB has a few pricing options that use RUs. Let's quickly introduce those as well. We have autoscale and standard provision throughput, as well as serverless. Throughput provisioning tends to be a Goldilocks problem where you want to get it just right. If you over-provision, you'll have all the compute on the cloud available, but it's not cost-effective because you're paying for unused capacity. If you under-provision, then it may not be optimal from a performance standpoint, but you won't have to spend any money. Each of the models I just mentioned offer a set of benefits depending on the use case, and we'll dive into that on the RU episode. So to bring us back to the previous thread, things we should know on day one are how we're going to design our schema, how we're going to partition our data, and how to think about request units. Some of the other important topics developers should understand eventually, but aren't necessarily a big headache to change once you get the other three things right, are things like indexing, security features such as IP firewall, monitoring, and consistency. Things like this are important to database optimization and security, but are fairly easy to change after the fact. All right, so that concludes the first episode. We discussed how to think about the APIs and considerations when building new apps or migrating existing workloads with Cosmos DB. We also introduced some of the foundational concepts for getting the most out of Cosmos DB, regardless of which API you choose: schema design, partition strategy, and request units. Join me in the next three episodes to dive into the things to know on day one in depth, starting with the upcoming episode on request units.